Hello everyone, and welcome back to Carol Crafty Grandma. This is part three in our series, and again, I have messed up my camera. This has got to be me setting it up because it's just sitting at an angle funny. There we go. And it's probably just my eyes. There, no, it's much better now. All right, so welcome back to part three of the May Bench Pillows for All Seasons. This is the book. It's from annieskatalog.com. And they are pillow covers for 12 months for a 38 by 16 inch pillow. I personally just made my own 38 by 16 inch pillow. You can do whatever you want. There are a limited number of them of that exact size that I found available on the internet. But there were some available. Again, I had white fabric, I had stuffing, I just made my own pillow. It just seemed easier to me. So today we are going to try to finish this pillow cover for May. I don't know if we're going to be able to make it or not, just because of the fact that there are things that we have to do that I've never done before. So if you watched part two, you saw that I figured out how to make the leaves. I have my, you can't see it at all, but I have my little template. It's a plastic piece of, if I move it, you can kind of see it's there in my hand. it's a piece of clear plastic that I'm using to outline the leaves. I have three leaves here on the dark green. I'm going to use the light green and make some more. And I thought about it. I did a test with the light, with the dark green yesterday. That's how we know I know what I'm how to do what they're asking me to do. And on the picture, in the directions, it says to make, it just says to make 9 leaves. It doesn't say what color, what size, whatever. So it just says to make the 9 leaves. It does say to make some reversed, but that doesn't make any sense to me because the pattern is both ways. So I'm not certain what they mean by that. So I originally was going to make 5 dark green and 4 light green. Well, yellow green, whatever color you want to call that. And if you've been watching any of the other bench pillow shows, you know I've been using this as stems and leaves and everything for about a year. It was a full, it was a jelly roll of all green with the yellow tinge. So it's the perfect color for leaves and stems, and I'll probably be using that for the next 3 years based on how much there is of it. So I'm going to make 3 dark colored leaves and 5 and 6 light colors. The reason is this color here is not the white that they called for in the book. They called for like a white color, and I used more of a yellowish color, which is pulling the yellow from the border a lot. I thought making the blue birds would pull more of my little blue flowers. I mean, you can't even see that flower. This one is bigger. No, maybe that one. Yeah, you can kind of see. You can see that there's blue in here, but the green, actually, I'm doing it backwards. I'm telling you lies. I'm going to make 6 of the dark green. So I've got 3 here, and I'm going to make 3 more. And I'm only going to make 3 of the light yellow green because there is so much yellow. That's where I was going with that. My mind just didn't click. Because there is so much yellow on this already. I am going to put some dark green in to see if I can pull some more of, because even the green on the border is more of a yellow green, which is why you're not seeing too many. There's red, there's blue flowers in here that you're just not seeing a lot of. And then I am going to use the darker red and some pinks and stuff like that. And I'm probably even going to throw in some blue flowers. I am not going to do any yellow flowers for that. With that in mind, we're going to be making yo-yos today. I have never used my yo-yo maker, so you're going to watch me have fun. That's not up there, it's down there. So my hand needles, they're normally sitting right up here. I moved them down there for something and never put them back. So at least I know where they're at. They're not missing. So we are going to use my yo-yo maker. Again, haven't opened it even, haven't tried it. Looks like I tried to make something out of one of the yo-yo makers at some point in time. I don't remember doing it, but it could have been 10, 15 years ago for all I know, and I just didn't get that far. Or I could have lent it to my mother, and my mother could have used it. Again, I'm not certain how it got open, why it's been used. I have no idea. All I know is I need to make some yo-yos, and I am not going to make any yellow flowers. I think there's enough yellow on this quilt already, so we don't need any yellow flowers. We're going to go with blue flowers and red and pink flowers and make that, you know, try and get those colors to pop a little bit more so that it's not just yellow. So, all that being said, the first thing we need to do is we need to quilt the top. So what we've been doing thus far is called piecing the top. We've done applique to put things on it. We've done piecing to put the border on it. We've pieced the top. We now have to actually quilt the fabric. And I am not going to do much quilting because when I put these leaves on, they are going to be attached using stitching to this. So it will be going through all three layers because we're going to quilt this first. And the batting that I use requires at least 8 inches between quilting in order for the batting to not clump up and make a mess. And since this is 16 inches, this will end up being 16 inches. Of course it will. 38 by 16. Duh. Sorry. Brain not functioning. All right. Since this will end up being 16 inches across, I really only have to quilt right down the middle. I am going to quilt around that. That's all I'm going to do quilting-wise today. Well, and then put the leaves on. Because like I said, the leaves will all be in the middle, and that'll guarantee me at least 8 inches. And since they're going to be across here, I'm going to have no more than 8 inches anywhere along either side also. So that's how we're going to do the quilting for this. We're going to just whip through, stitch in the ditch around the border. And stitch in the ditch means we stitch between these two pieces of fabric. The area between it is called the ditch. And so we're going to stitch in that ditch all the way around on all four sides. And that's all we're going to do to attach the pillow top to the batting to the backing. When I make these pillow covers, I use muslin for the back of the quilt. No one is going to see the back of the quilt. The pillow is in the pillow cover, the front of the cover, which is this, then the batting, and then the backing, and then the pillow, and then the envelope. So the only person that's ever going to see the back of the quilt is whoever is changing. I was going to say me, because it is typically me. But if I were to have someone else change out the pillow cover for the month, they would see the back of the quilt. I don't care. If it's someone that I'm having change it, it means I don't care what they see. So it makes no difference. There's no reason to waste perfectly good fabric on the back of the quilt. Now, on the back of the envelope part that goes around the pillow, around the back, that we're going to use good fabric for. And actually, we're going to use this same fabric again, which I've never done, and I mentioned that in part one. I've never done it where the border and the envelope back are the same fabric. So I'll be interested to see if that makes it look too busy to me when it's sitting on the pillow. Because where the pillow sits, my chair is here and the TV is over here. So I'm looking that way to watch TV as I'm knitting, crocheting, doing whatever I'm doing. And the pillow sits right here in front of our fish tank. We've got a little bench in front of our fish tank. And so it sits right there in front of the fish tank. So I see the side of that pillow all the time. And I don't know if having the same color is going to be weird for me or if it's not. We'll have to find out. All right, so the first thing I needed was the backing. And when I make these, I'm able to get two backings out of one piece of muslin. So I cut it. It's more than 38. Obviously, you don't want to go the same size. You need a bigger piece. Let's see, we're at 30, 35. This one happens to be 42 inches wide. So that's 38. So it's not an even number. I just cut it the width that I did. Usually I put the same number of inches on either side just to sort of even it out, but I didn't. And then it is 20 inches, so it's got 2 inches on the top, 2 inches on the bottom. If you are having these professionally quilted by someone that has a long arm, they're going to need a lot more space than that. But since I'm just doing it on here, and again, I wouldn't waste the money with a long arm quilting because this isn't that big of a deal. This is, you know, simple. Now I need batting. Let's see. Where's my closest hunk of batting? There we go. All right. And I want the batting to be about the same size as the backing. They always need to be bigger than the top because that way, if you do any, when you quilt, you tend to do a little bit of squeezing stuff in and it moves a little bit. So you always want to make sure that you have more batting and backing than you have pieced top. All right. Let's go right about there. Go off to the side here. Cut down. And now where are we at? Now I tend to cut at an angle. I don't know how many of you do that too. I think I'm cutting straight and I'm not. So I end up with wonky shaped pieces. I do have these big tables and I could always clean them off and cut these perfectly straight. I think it's a waste of my time. Not cleaning off the table. Cleaning off the table would be fine. But you're just going to cut it off anyway. It doesn't have to be straight. It doesn't have to be perfect. It just has to have enough room that you can quilt. So now I'm going to take my batting and my fabric and my backing fabric. And see if I can match it up. And I can. And you can see that the batting is bigger than the backing all the way around. So we're good. That over just a little bit. And this is why I don't like doing big projects, because I just like to be done with it. Big projects require way too much room over there and over here. And no big projects. I like little projects. Now, the next project I'm going to do, which is either going to be Monday or Tuesday of next week, I'm going to start a bag, an actual purse, not just a bag, but a purse. I've actually got one in pieces at the end of this table that I've not finished, which I need to do, but I haven't. But I figured I'd do a different one. That one's kind of complicated. It's got curves and multiple layers and stuff like that, so I'm not going to mess with this one's simpler. It's got like 5 pieces to it. It has 5 pattern pieces. And then it's got a lining that's the same as pattern piece on the outside. It's got a zipper in it, which is kind of cool. But it doesn't have a zipper across the top. It's got a zipper on a pocket, so it's a much smaller area. So depending on how long it takes to do this, I'm guessing, and especially as much as I'm talking today, I'm guessing we're going to be doing a part 4 of this pillow cover. So that will, the purse will be the next one after that. The fabric is ordered. I had some fabric that I could have used. But instead of making a white purse, I want to make a gray purse. So I ordered gray vinyl. I only had white vinyl. So I ordered some gray vinyl, and that should be here in a couple of days. And then I'm going to use some of the military fabric from Labor Day as the accent fabric. I will tell you right now, it will most likely, well, not most likely, it will be the Air Force fabric, because my son is in the Air Force, and therefore I want to be able to support that particular branch. But I will look at I have 2 different fabrics for all of the branches except for Space Force, which makes me very upset. And I talked about this during my Labor Day project, because there's nothing out there for the Space Force. And I'm like, how am I supposed to do a Labor Day quilt without representing all 5 branches of the military? Well, needless to say, like I said, it's not available. I've sent a message to some different suppliers saying, hey, this is something we need, and of course, haven't heard anything. Why is it so dark over by my, I guess it's my imagination. All right, let's go over here. And I'm gonna leave the quilt on the table for the time being, because we have to switch back from our regular foot to our walking foot. I'm gonna leave the black on, because again, I'm trying to get some more color in this quilt, and right now it's just all yellow. So I am gonna quilt it in black. And I'm gonna do something that may bother some of you, but others of you are gonna be like, okay. I am not going to change out. I'm gonna leave my universal 80 needle on. I am not gonna switch to a quilting needle, because we are going to do such a small amount of quilting. I mean, we're actually going to be doing a lot of quilting here in a little bit, but the quilting that we're going to be doing is with the leaves getting attached, and I'm just not really, I see no reason to switch to a quilting needle that I'm going to use a very little bit. I have them. But this is also a way of saying you don't have to always use a quilting needle. It's got a longer eye, so this little thing where the thread goes through is longer. Instead of being here, it's almost like double the width or length. So the thread can flow easier as the needle goes up and down. I did switch to my walking foot because we are going to be dealing with multiple layers of fabric. And so I'm going to use that. My walking foot has the ability to have different feet on it. So this thing here. And this has a thing that goes down the middle so that I'll be able to stitch in the ditch straight. Doesn't always work well as well for me as it should. You'd think I'd be able to do it, but still, doesn't always work for me. And we will be switching to the non-stitch in the ditch foot when I switch over to doing the leaves. All right, so stitch in the ditch around the border. Let's get you over here. All right, and I don't start at a corner. Some people do, some I don't. I like to start somewhere in the middle so that I can start and finish my thread and knot it. All right, so. Switch it to needle down. I did not increase the stitch length. Let me increase the stitch length. There we go. All right. So now there's a piece of metal here on the front of my foot that I'm going to keep right in what's called the ditch, the area between the two pieces of fabric, and see if I can get it to go straight down. You want to stretch the fabric and keep all three layers tight. As you can see, it starts to bubble a little bit. You want to keep it flat and tight. Comes the corner. You want to keep your corner at 90 degrees. So you want to keep this straight and sharp and don't put any bubbles in it. When I say bubbles, I mean you don't have the fabric. It's extreme when I say like this. But make sure your corner stays at 90 degrees. Now we're going to go this way. Again, keep your fabric straight and flat. Another corner.
Oops. I went out the ditch. I knew I was going to do that at some point. I was going too fast. Almost done. Stay in the ditch. Yeah. Pulled out of the ditch right at the end there. So now we have our pillow top stitched in the ditch, and you can see in the back, we just did a big rectangle. You can't really because I've got it folded funny, but there we go. All right. And I'm going to guess there's some of you out there going, every other time you've done this, you've put safety pins in and tightened it up before you did it. And you're right. Every other time I've done a bench pillow for all seasons, I have done that. I didn't mess with it today because I was only doing the square. I knew what I was, where I was going. There wasn't anything complicated. And with my table, I was able to keep it straight and flat because my table's wide enough that I was able to get all of this on there. If you don't have a table, or whatever, even if you're just starting out, put your safety pins in. Make sure everything is nice and tight. Put your safety pins in. I didn't have to on this one. I felt comfortable not doing it. So that's why, no freaking out necessary. I didn't change what I do. Well, I did, but that's just because I didn't have to worry about it this time. Okay. Now, just like every other bench pillow of the month, we line up our ruler on a short side. And in this case, it was 4.5 inches wide when we started. We've lost 1/4 inch because we stitched. So we're going to line it up on 4 1/4 all the way up. And then we're going to trim off our batting and backing. And throw it in the garbage. Then we're going to switch to the other short side. Do the same thing. 4 1/4. And line it up all the way down on the seam. In the garbage it goes. And then I think this was 2.5. And this we have to do in stages. That's why I'm off to the side, because my cutting board is longer this way. So now we line it up at 2 1/4 for this border. And we square it with the cut side that we just made. And that's a little bit trickier. Does take some effort to actually make sure you're square everywhere. or in both spots, not just on one spot. Take your time. Square it up. Now we're going to move it down. And now we're able to do the same thing, but from the top edge. So line it up. Make sure you're where you've already cut is square. Sorry, somebody rang the doorbell. Cats scattered. I had to see what it was. I think it was Walmart. Could have been the Amazon delivery. I'm not certain. Because I did order. So this is going to be fun with the purse. I ordered RFID reflective fabric to put in the purse. So that the whole purse will be able to keep RFID. It was Walmart. What did I get from Walmart? Oh, cat litter. Cat litter. That's what's at the... All right, there we go. So now we have trimmed off one of the long edges, and now we're going to do the other long edge. I don't know where to put the ruler. Now, the wide border doesn't have a stitch line in it, so I'm only lining up with the stitch line to the shorter border. I'm squaring it up at the corner and on the bottom. So I've got everything. I've actually got 3 points. I said two before. There's actually three. It's at this 90 degree angle where the borders meet and the cut edge that we did earlier. Weird. Okay. All right. There we go. So I'm going to move to the zoom in camera here. Let me get this ruler out of the way. And I'm going to show you what I said was weird. So right here, there's batting. There's an area where there's no fabric. There's only batting. This side of the border did not stitch, was not as long as it should have been, I guess, because it didn't stitch up well, or didn't stitch all the way to the edge. Now, I am going to be putting a 1/4 inch seam on the edge because we're going to match up the envelopes here later on. And my little gadget here, this piece is 1/4 inch. So if I put it on the edge of the batting, it goes above the fabric just a bit. So we're okay. We're going to be able to hide that without a problem because It's just under 1/4 inch. So we should be okay. If that had been larger than 1/4 inch, we would have been starting this whole project over again. Or, since it's a pillow cover, and pillows can expand or contrast depending on how much you stuff them. Instead of using a quarter of an inch seam, use a 3/8. 3/8 is 6/4. No. 1 1/2/4. So it's a little bit over. Yeah, I thought it was. It's just, it's 1/8 of an inch over 1/4 of an inch. So it would add just a little bit onto it so that you can get that, make sure that fabric is all caught in there correctly. Okay, water. Been talking a lot. Need water. All right. Sorry, I was looking at the books that are the camera's standing on, and I realized that one of them is missing. It has to be around here somewhere. I'm just not certain where. Because I use it for other videos. Well, I will be using it for other videos, and I was preparing for that, and that's why I'm like, I'm not certain what I did with it. All right, so now back to these leaves. Move the book out of the way, because we're not going to need the iron. We're going to be pretty good there. And actually, let's iron some fabric. So remember I said we're going to make 6 or 5. Should we make 5? No, I want to do 6. I want to use the least amount of that as possible, but I do want to have a little bit of contrast in there. All right, so I need twice as much fabric as I have here, because I don't like the way these turned out. That was my test batch yesterday. I'm just not crazy about it. So there's 3, and there's 3 more. Okay. That back there out of the way, and I need that up here. All right, so this is the fabric I'm going to use for my dark green leaves. I like the way this looks. I think it will work nicely for giving some kick of color to that fabric right now. And so first I'm going to iron this so it's a little bit flatter and straighter. And my iron's not hot because it was sitting up there upright. I have one of the irons that when you turn it down, when you have it sitting upright for too long, it stops the heat. It doesn't turn off, but it just stops the heat. And so you have to turn it down and back up in order for it to warm back up. All right, so I don't need this. I'm gonna throw that away. Then I'm gonna need another piece of batting that is about the same length, which that is, and about the same width, which it will be as soon as I cut it. All right, so that's gonna make 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Yes, there are 9 leaves on here. Batting, I'm gonna need to iron that too. So I use cotton batting. So when you heard me just mumble, and when I pointed at the batting, I'm gonna need to iron that too. I can iron my batting because it's cotton batting. If you are using a batting that is polyester, you cannot iron it. Do not iron it. It will melt, depending on the amount of polyester in it. And I've never tried a polyester blend, so if it's cotton poly blend, the polyester is going to melt. Polyester is not heat, doesn't resist heat. Heat resistant. Resist heat, duh. All right, so the polyester will melt. Mine will not because it is cotton. And I really don't need to iron the batting, but I'm going to. Just because I've still never actually completed one of these. I did one yesterday. I got the gist of it. I know what I'm doing. But I've never actually completed one. And I want the least amount of resistance as I can. And having flat fabric instead of wrinkled fabric and having flat batting instead of wrinkled batting is going to be helpful. All right. So I'm going to take this. This is the right side. This is the wrong side. Honestly, with fabric like this, it doesn't matter that much. You could use either side, but I want the darkest green I can get to combat all the yellow that's in this quilt. So I'm going to lay it right side up. Fabric is right side up. And I am going to fold it in half. We're not worrying about whether the fabric is straight on grain or anything like that. That is not something we need to worry about right now. We are just folding the fabric in half. And if you have two pieces of fabric, this can be done, because we're going to end up doing that with, well, no, I'm going to fold it there too. But this is literally getting two pieces of fabric face to face, right side to right side. You could also use two different fabrics. This is just dawning on me as I'm standing here doing this. Because what I could do is use the light green for the back of the leaf and the dark green for the front of the leaf. And because it's only going to be attached at the stem points, so it's going to pop out. It's going to be three-dimensional. That's the purpose of this. And then you would only see the yellow, the back side of the leaf, if you were looking for it. I'm not going to do that. I thought about it for a minute there, but I changed my mind. All right. So now I'm going to do, let's see. Act. So I'm going to take my batting. It's going to be in the back. I'm going to take my fabric, which again, this is just two pieces of fabric with right sides together. Doesn't have to be the same fabric. It doesn't have to be folded over. If you have scraps, whatever, just do that. And actually, I don't think I'm going to need nearly as much because the leaf itself, I may be able to get six on this piece of batting. Let's see. Shift. All right. Move that batting up. So it's all underneath. And go back to my pen. I'm using a Sharpie because I'm going to stitch inside the lines. If you're going to not stitch inside the lines, you need to not use a Sharpie because it will bleed onto your fabric and you will see it later on. All right. And the slash line. You know what I should? Yes, I'm going to do that. So there's a line on here where it says, I wrote slash, but it's too blurry. There we go, where I wrote slash. Then the brown lines are where we're going to do the stitching. So I'm actually going to cut my plastic where it says slash. I'm going to fold it a little bit, not a lot, just a little bit. Not completely in half, but just enough so I can get it started. And I'm going to cut on the slash line on the plastic template. And the reason I did that is because I am now going to take, oh, now you're all blurry again. Let's refocus. Now I am going to take my pen, and on that slash line that I've cut, I'm going to draw that on the leaf. So here we go. I have a leaf drawn and I have the slash line drawn. So that's one. Come on. There's two. Now don't get them too close to each other, because remember, you're going to have to stitch inside the line slightly, and then you're going to have to cut them apart. And you, during the test one, I cut it too close to the stitch line, and the fabric came apart. So you don't want to put them too close together, but you want to get, you don't want to use up too much fabric. You don't want to waste fabric either. I mean, I guess if it's scrap fabric, it really doesn't matter. That's four. Yeah, I'm only going to get five on this piece of batting, but I'm not going to have to use much more of the other piece. Go all the way over here to get on this other piece of batting. Otherwise I'd have half and half batting, and I didn't join them together, I just put them next to each other. If I had actually physically joined the two pieces of batting together, I wouldn't have cared, but I didn't. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I now have 6 leaves in dark green. So I decide I want to make more in dark green. Now let's go to the sewing machine. And I'm going to leave the black thread on because I just don't care. Black works. I'm taking off my stitch in the ditch foot and I'm putting on my regular foot, which still only has the dot down the center, so it's only a straight stitch foot. I can't do any zigzag stitches or anything fancy. I can just do straight stitch. But it's got the walking foot, so it's got the feed dogs on the top, and then the feed dogs obviously on the bottom of the machine. So all three layers, that's going to be nice and smooth. So just inside the line. Oh, I lower the stitch by length back. All right. Let's see. Let's get around these curves slowly so that our leaves curve nicely. We don't want the leaves to be too pointy. Now, yesterday when I did this test, I did the slashes before I stitched. Now that I'm thinking, that might have been a better idea. So we're only going to go as far as doing this one right now, So I might have screwed up already. All right, now we want to point on this leaf. All right, let's go back over here, because I think I might have messed up. Let's try. All right. So, here's the other five. So here's the stitching. And come on, focus. There we go. So the line on the inside is the black stitching line that I made. The line on the outside is the line that I used to draw the pattern. And then the line down the middle is the slash line. And the slash line needs to only go on one half of the leaf. And typically, you fold it in half to make a slash line. You fold it in half and cut. But because I stitched it already, I can't do that. So let me see if I can get it started and only cut the one side. So I did. I was able to get that done, but it was challenging. So we're going to cut all of these. We're going to cut all the slash lines before we sew them on the rest of these. So. Line, and we're just cutting the line. That's all we're doing. Cutting along the slash line. Definitely easier to do it right now than it was to do that one. All right, let's see. All cut. There's that. Now let's look at how this is going to work. For those of you that saw part two, you saw this already. For those of you that didn't see part two, this will be new for you. I'm going to cut just outside the line I drew now. Although, yeah, they do look pointed. So at the tip, I'm going to cut right close to the line of thread without cutting the thread. This is what you do at corners when you turn them right side out. We're going to do that same task later when we do the envelope. So come on. Stop focusing on that. Focus on the leaf. It's focusing everywhere but where I want it to. Yeah, I gotta get it. Let's see if I can go this way and put my hands behind it. Wrong way. There we go. All right. There we go. See how I cut right close to the tip? That's going to give me a nice smooth point. We want the point to be as sharp as we can get it. And the way we do that is we cut right next to the thread. Don't cut the thread, because if you cut the thread, it's not going to work. All right, back to focus out here. So now we take the slash point where we cut our fabric, and we turn everything right side out. And I said yesterday that I always fuss when I make a purse or a bag or something and I have to do this, and it always seems like such a challenge. And it's actually to get, and I always thought it was because getting a lot of fabric out through a little line on a purse was a pain in the butt. Turns out this is just as much of a pain in the butt. This little stuff is just as annoying. Okay, so now we're going to push out where the seams are. Come on. Okay, that's kind of rounded. That's not the pointed edge. This side is the pointy edge. I'm going to get a knitting needle. Come on, there we go. I'm going to use that as, there are gadgets you can buy that are official for turning things right side out and so on and so forth. I've never found them to be of much use, so I just use the stuff I already have. Get that as pointy as I can. That's why I cut it the way I did. So there we go. This is the back side of the leaf. This is going to be against the fabric, and this is the front side of our leaf. And now we have a three-dimensional leaf. Does it say to stitch? Top stitch and or quilt and apply to project as indicated in pattern. Let's see. I have no idea if they top stitched it. I can't tell. And there are no other, now there are that, because that's another picture of it, but it's just as far away. So I am not, I'm not going to top stitch it. I want it to kind of look natural, so I'm going to go with that thought process, because like this one, it's going to go like right there, and it's going to be stitched down the center, and then one stitch off to the side and one stitch off to the side, and then so this part, these parts will like be loose, they won't be attached to the fabric, so that's where that one's going to go. That leaf is going to go right there. All right, let's make 5 more of these. And then we'll switch to the other color. I'm not going to stop between each of these leaves. I'm just going to stitch them. Then I'm going to walk over and cut them and turn them. And I am doing my knot at the beginning of my stitching. Oh, wrong way. Cut. I started stitching on the outside of the line, not the inside of the line. All right, there we go. So this side is my pointy side. So I go up, I'm gonna go one more, and then I go down. So there's no curve at all to that. It's just a sharp point.
Oh, sorry.
Coughed right into the microphone. Sorry about that, folks. That's why I try and drink water throughout the day.
Actually, I'm going to get my water because my throat is
dry. So now down here at the other end of the leaf, I am going to go across a couple stitches and then go back up. So it's kind of rounded at the bottom instead of pointy. So I have one pointy side and one rounded side. And like I said, I am doing the knot at the beginning and the end because when we flip these out, I don't want any of the threads pulling loose. Stop. Thank you. My watch is going bonkers today. I don't know what's going on. Everybody's chit-chatting and going bonkers. Thursday, not Friday. They all should be working, right? Except me. This is my work. No, it's not even Thursday. Yeah, it is. It's Thursday. It's supposed to be doing a knitting. I'm going to start doing knitting and crocheting videos on Thursday. Well, knitting videos on Thursday at this point in time. But with my grandkids in town and everything happening the way it did, and so I wasn't able to do a video on Monday, I decided I would do all three videos this week. All right, somebody's... The girls in the neighborhood are going to lunch next Friday. Let's see what's going on. I'll have to look at my schedule. Yep, did it again. Last one I managed to do it without getting too close, but this one I did it again. This will be the last dark one. Excellent. Sorry, a lot of chit-chatting going on. I won't be able to reply until we're done with this, so we'll find out how many reply by that point. All right, so now I'm going to cut, just like I did before, just outside the line on the leaves. That way I know that I have room and I don't cut the seam like I did on my test piece on part two. Those are pointy ones. I haven't cut the points off yet. I'm just trimming around the outline. Go. So now I'm going to switch to the little scissors I didn't do that the first time around, but I am going to do it this time just because I don't want to take a chance of cutting it too close. Or actually cutting it. Too close is good, or close is good. As close as possible is what you're shooting for. My little clipping. Whoa! That was really loud, scared the daylights out of my kitty cat. I forgot my step stool was leaning up against the garbage can. Okay. But with all those little bits, I needed to use the garbage can. Or pick up the garbage can. Alright. Yeah. Knitting needle. Otherwise known as poker. What size is this? 5.5. You okay, Cals? You good, baby? She didn't run away, so I guess I'm safer than anything else in the house right now. In my house right now, I have a third cat visiting. We normally have two. We've got a 2-year-old and an 8-year-old. My 3-year-old grandkitty is staying with us while my son and his family move from one duty station to another duty station, which happens to have, the new one happens to be down here with me. The duty station's like an hour and a half away. They're looking at living about an hour away, which is going to be great because they've been as far away as England at points in his career, so having them nearby is going to be nice. But so needless to say, the kitty cats are having a bit of a, you know, dust up as to who's in charge and who isn't in charge. So the 8-year-old likes to hang out in here. She finds it safe. This is her getaway from all of the recklessness of the 2-year-old and the 3-year-old. I say that, and as I was talking about her, she left. There's two. Put this up here because I don't think I'm going to need it anymore. But as all of you are aware that have watched me for any length of time, I say that and then I end up needing it because it always happens to me. I'm going to run out of water today. I don't know why I'm so parched. Oh, what time is it? Ah. We are definitely going to have a part 4 because I haven't even gotten to figuring out how to do the yo-yos yet, and I still have to finish these and 3 more in the light green and then attach them. So definitely having a part 4. Part 4 is going to start with how to make a yo-yo. Maybe I'll take the time over the weekend to actually make one. I modeled this video. Now, I do it live, and he does not. There's a gentleman by the name of Barry Lewis who does cooking shows. And he's been cooking on YouTube for a long time. Traffic backup. And if you get a chance to watch him, he's really good. He's funny. But so he doesn't do test runs on his stuff. He does his videos, and they are live and realistic, and this is just the way things go. And that's kind of how I've modeled this station also. I like to just do... I like to sew. I've been sewing for a very long time, decades. But as far as making the same thing twice, I like to do new stuff. I like to try new things. All of these patterns, at this point, I've never made before. So they're all new to me. Although the idea of doing them makes perfect sense. How they work, how to do things, I understand completely. Even the yo-yos, I've seen them done. I've just personally never had a reason to make one. But I took the time to buy the gadgets 20 years ago when I worked in a retail craft shop, and I got discounts on things. I did take the time to buy the stuff that, thinking that someday I might need them, and I do. They come in handy. It's just I haven't necessarily always used them before. So that's where I got the idea. Now, he does not do his live. He records, he edits, he does all that. My computer's just more challenging to use, and I'm still working on getting enough money from my little quilting business to invest in a higher-end computer. I could buy a higher-end computer. I don't want to do it unless I've made the money I need from crafting, because it works just fine for what I need it to do normally. It's just not a computer, a video editing computer. It needs some more oomph to it to do that. So I can't justify buying a new computer just because I want one for this until I can make enough money from this to do that. So there are things available on Etsy, by the way, if you want. Some of the things I've made, some of them I didn't sell, and I just haven't reposted, but there are items that I've made on this stream that you can purchase if you're so inclined. And you can go to patreon.com. I have a Patreon account if you want to give me money to keep doing this. Or if you want to see shorter videos, because once I am able to edit videos, I'm going to do shorter videos. I'm going to try this weekend. I think it's this weekend, maybe next weekend. And see if I can get at least one video edited down. Because I do want to do these books that the computer or that the camera is sitting on. I've recorded one video from them, and I would like to get those out once a week in addition to the lives, because I know I don't have time to edit a ton, because it takes me a long time to edit on my computer that I have now. That's the problem. I can do it, it just takes a really long time to do it. So I am trying to do that, and then I mentioned earlier, normally on Thursdays I'm going to be doing a knitting video. I'm going to switch over Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, I'm going to try and do quilting live streams, and they may not be quilting, sewing live streams, I should say that, because I do want to make this purse that I've got a pattern for. It's over there. I'm thinking about making a matching wallet and a matching glasses case, just to complete the set. I found patterns for chapstick holders. I thought that was interesting because I do use a lot of chapstick too. Not as much as my niece does, but I do use chapstick. So that could be fun to make a chapstick holder. Just to make things that all go together. And depending on the size, the purse looks like it's going to be really big. And I don't know if I'm going to like carrying a really big purse. So if it does turn out to be really big, I will probably put it up for sale on Etsy. I haven't quite figured out how to use Facebook Marketplace yet, so we'll see if that is something I can figure out, but I don't know. All right, I now have 5 leaves. And I know one of them is going to go on the end. Let's see. Let's get some pins. See if this works. Or if pins make everything too heavy and I can't. No, I don't want it there. I want it there. Come on. There we go. There. I like that one. All right. Then there's supposed to be one on the end of this little one. There's two. Let's see, where else does it have a dark one? Right here. There's that one. I need to put legs on the bird. I forgot to put legs on the bird when we quilted. Then another one here. One, two, three, four. So those are where the 4 dark ones go, according to that. I am going to put another dark one over here. By the way, if you've ever used a magnetic pin holder, the pins become sort of magnetic and they start to stick to each other. Just an FYI. There are a lot of people that hate using magnetic pin holders for just that reason. And I get it. I just like them. Dang it. Put that one there. And let's see. So, got a light one there. Light one there. I'm going to put a dark one here. Does it actually? It comes really close. And it's going to fall again, of course. There we go. All right. So now we've got those placed. You're starting to see how it's coming together. So it was looking really bland. Now we've got a little more color on it. And actually, I do think it makes the blue stand out a little bit more. Not a ton yet. I'm seeing it more on that far border. But it is making other colors, making the yellow not as dominant. I like that. All right. I need this. I just need one of you. All right, Actually, I'm going to use this batting. And now I only need 3 leaves. One, two, and 3. Yes. Now, can I get 3 out of the batting I have here? Let's find out. I think I can. All right, so we have the first one. Now this fabric is thinner, as in it has a lower thread count, I believe, in my opinion, than the last fabric I used. And it's making a little more of a, it moves a little bit more. In the slash line. 2 and 3. All right, I want this to be the tip. Just putting a little mark on there so that I know that's where I want the tip to be. Let's cut off that part of the fabric. Get the slashes. Sorry, I gotta move it down a little bit. It's too far away for me to. And I almost did this wrong. And you're probably all sitting there laughing, going, oh no, she's going to do it the wrong way. That goes there. This goes on top. This goes on top of that. It's 2 pieces of fabric, right sides together, batting on the bottom. That's how we're able to get things to turn right side out with the batting in the middle. All right, preview, there we go. Just inside the line. I almost went outside again. Oops, go down. Went too far. Actually worked out. All right. And this is the pointed side, so I go straight up and then straight down. Ah! So I'm coming to the rounded side of the leaf. Last one. Oops, didn't cut. Come on, there we go. I don't need those scissors with me. They stay by the sewing machine. All right. Cutting around the outside of the leaf. All right, so we'll pull out our poker. So thinking about it, I was telling you, I kind of modeled this show after the cooking by videos by Barry Lewis. Steve was watching a woodworking show on YouTube last night. And the guy said that he did a little test where he edited a video twice. The first one, he kept it longer, and the second one, he cut it down so that it was only, I think he made the comment, it's like 7 minutes long or whatever. So the shorter side of YouTube. And he received like 5 million views on the short 7 minute or however many long minutes video, and he only received like 100,000 video views of his other. Now to me this seems like, you know, massive, because I'm lucky if I get 10 views. That makes me happy if I just get 10 views. Again, I haven't been on nearly as long as this guy, so I'm just starting out, so I'm not feeling terrible yet. Another 3 years, I'll start to feel bad if I still only get 10 views. But anyway, so his comment was that people don't like to watch things actually get done. So what this video was about tape measures, which, you know, we have ours that are little, that we're talking woodworking, construction type tape measures. And he had two tape measures, and he had them taped on a piece of wood, And he pulled them out and let them go loose back over and over and over again until they broke. Trying to see if you, how long they lasted, or it was something like that. And in the video that only had, that had the 10 million views, nobody knew why he was doing it. All he was doing, he never said, I mean, the description kind of said testing tape measures. But he had no sound, no words. He didn't talk about anything. He just sped up the video of him pulling the tape measures out, letting them go, pulling them out, letting them go, pulling them out, letting it go. And people, 10 million people watched him do that. But the long video where he talked about why he was doing it, which brands, what type of tests he was doing, how he decided to do it, you know, the actual descriptions of what he was doing, he didn't get many views at all on. So his comment was, people don't watch description or how-to videos. People don't actually watch them for the how-to part. They just watch them for entertainment purposes. And I'm hoping that's not true. Because if that's true, then you're never, nobody else is ever going to watch these videos, because they're very long. And I actually do the work. I show you all the steps. I mean, if you were so inclined, you could actually sew along with me. Now, some people have go slower, go some go faster, you know. You may get tired of watching me. Or you may find that I go too fast because your skill, you feel your skill set's lower. I don't agree, because I think I take the same amount of time as anybody would do, but I could be wrong. But yes, I think doing longer videos so you can see all of the steps, not just when it comes out right, but everything, is very important. Okay. We now have three light green leaves. First one is going to go over here. Too far up. There we go. That one's going to go there. That's over there. That's down there. All right, so these two go over here. This one's going to be right at the point. Whee! Everything falls. Excellent. And then this one, last one, is going to go at the opposite side of that one. So going the same direction, but on the other side of the leaf. All right. So here we go. We have our leaves laid out. Let me step aside so you can see. So now we have our leaves laid out. So where we're at time-wise is where we're gonna stop today. So part four. Part four, we're gonna learn how to make yo-yos, not pom-poms, yo-yos. I have pom-pom mixers in the same basket as I have yo-yo makers. So we'll learn how to make those. And then we're going to put all of the items on. So the leaves are on with pins right now. They're not actually attached to the quilt top. And that is because there's going to be some of the yo-yos are flowers. Well, all of the yo-yos are flowers. And I want to see where they fit before I actually apply the leaves, so that I make sure that, because most the leaf tips, these things where they're at the bottom here, that's where the flowers go. And I just want to make sure I have room enough to put flowers where I need to and have them not on top of each other or whatever, looking silly. So we'll make the yo-yos. We'll attach the yo-yos. We'll attach the leaves. We will put the buttons on for eyes. I have to remember to put the bird's legs on. I have to remember to do that. And then we will put the envelope on the back of it so that it's done. And I do believe we should be able to do that in one part, one two-hour stint. It's gonna be tight. I'm gonna have to try and not talk too much. We'll have to see. I think I will probably leave it open-ended and just post the live stream for Monday, and I will wait to post whether Tuesday's live stream is going to be this again, part five, or if we're gonna start on the purse, which is really where I wanna go. I really wanna get going on that. I think that's gonna look neat. Like I said, I'm scared it's gonna be really big though. It just, the pattern looks really big. So thank you all for watching. Don't forget to like, subscribe, follow, whatever, love, thumbs up, things, whatever you're doing. Very much appreciated. That way we can get going on our algorithm and get some of these videos seen by other people. I would very much appreciate it. So you have a great day.